Hello and welcome to Croftlands Community Church and our service online this Mothering Sunday. It's lovely to have your company and I hope you are blessed by the service. A moment ago we were listening to a dawn chorus that I recorded from our bathroom window a few days ago. This wonderful sound reminds me of some words from the Bible. Psalm 150 verse 6 says, "Let everything that has breath praise the Lord." It's a short psalm. Let's read it together now. Psalm 150. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and lyre. Praise him with the tambourine and dancing. Praise him with the strings and flute. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. The birds were singing to welcome a new day and for the pleasure of their Creator. Let's join them now as we respond to God's great love for us and sing for his pleasure and glory.
Changing, your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. A mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. Hallelujah.
We have two birthdays to mention this week. one of which I mustn't forget, and they're both on Thursday. Catherine and Richard, here is a picture with a connection for each of you. Long ago, Catherine had a German Shepherd puppy, and Richard enjoys learning the German language. We hope you have lovely birthdays, and God bless you both. And Richard, here's a little extra greeting for you.
Viel Glück und viel Segen auf all deinen Wegen, Gesundheit und Freude sei auch mit dabei.
Alles Gute zum Geburtstag, Richard.
Thank you, Kristen and Sonja, for that. Earlier we were singing, God's love makes us sing. One of the wonderful ways that God can express his love for us is through the heart of the women in our lives and communities, whether that be our mothers or some other woman who has impacted our lives with love, care and inspiration. The love, kindness and care of a good mother is an incredible expression of the heart of God. God says in Isaiah 66:13, as a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. What a beautiful picture. However, like any special occasion, today can be a painful time for many. For some, it can accentuate the grief of the loss of a child or mother. For others, it can underline the fact that they were not part of a loving family, and so Mother's Day reopens the scars. Whatever emotion today brings for you, we pray that you may experience God's comfort, love, and peace. I'm delighted now to introduce some of the 3- and 4-year-olds from Mrs. Henderson's class at the infant school who are going to sing us a Mother's Day song. Aren't they great? We'll be hearing from them again in a moment. What a lovely little song. I had to stop myself from joining in. Now, I thought I'd show you what I got for my mum for Mother's Day. I was very chuffed when I found this. It says, Mum, I'm happy I'm your kid, or your orchid. Here it is.
Thank you.
a quality gift. It's wonderful to know that whatever we go through in life, God knows and is watching over us. Matthew 10:29 says, "Are not two sparrows sold for a penny, yet not one of them fall to the ground outside your Father's care? And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid, you are worth more than many sparrows." The school children are going to help us with this next song by being sparrows, flowers and planets.
Thank you to the children and staff at Croftlands Infant School for helping with our service. Let's pray. Father God, you are almighty, creator of the universe, and yet you are so personal. Today we are thankful for your love and for those who have shown us love. We are especially grateful for the roles that caring women have played in our lives, whether that be our mums or someone else who has cared for us in some way and inspired us. Would you comfort all those for whom today is a sad day and brings a reminder of loss or rejection? Help us to experience your love in our hearts, the love that surpasses all other loves and knows every sparrow, every flower, every planet. You know everyone, and you know me. Amen.
What a hope.
Hello. I recently spent some time going through the Bible, looking at some verses that talk about setting your heart and mind on things. And there are loads of them. But don't worry, for this service, I'm just going to pick out three. Now, to set your heart and mind on something is to make a deliberate choice to go after something that's really important to you. It's a choice that's made on purpose, with a determination that actually whatever may come against this, I am not going to give up. And as I was thinking about Mother's Day, it struck me that many women are very good at setting their hearts on something until it happens. I suspect that many of you men may have experience in that area if your wife or partner has set her heart on something particular. Usually it's best to just go with it, if you want a quiet life, that is. For this service, I've picked out just three verses that talk about the deliberate decision to set oneself to something. First verse, and it's from Psalm 84. Blessed are those whose strength is in you, that's God, who have set their hearts on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. Set your heart on pilgrimage. Blessed are those who set their heart on living out their personal journey, discovering their God-given purpose and drawing on His strength. The verse goes on to say that as those people travel through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. Valley of Baca actually translates as Valley of Tears. The places of weeping and tears in our lives can become places of resource if we are walking through them with God. Fertile places of growth, places where we gain wisdom and learn personal lessons that become woven into our life story and bring about blessing in some unexpected way. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things, for you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. Set your mind on things above. As we face our personal challenges, our valley of tears, we can pre-decide to set our hearts on the bigger picture, the picture beyond our capacity to fully understand at the moment, where God is in control, weaving every situation and every life into His plan. As we pre-decide to set our mind on things above, we are setting ourselves to respond to the different landscapes of our personal life story with the values that operate and the way things work in the kingdom of God. We pre-decide to foster those attitudes from above, like faith, thankfulness, forgiveness, compassion, standing up for the weak and the vulnerable. So we set our hearts to walk the personal journey that God has planned for us in relationship with him, we set our minds on the values from above, which layer into us and flow out in our lifestyles. Therefore, with minds that are ready for action and self-controlled, set your hope fully on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. We set our hope fully on the grace to be given to us when Jesus returns. Our hope fully set in expectation of the grace of God at the end of the day, covering our lives, our actions, our mistakes, the things that we didn't fully understand. Grace that is greater than all of our sin. Why is it even possible to have such a hope? Because 2,000 or so years ago, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, set his face to go to Jerusalem, where he would be falsely accused, betrayed, and crucified. Even knowing this, and all the horrors in the valley that he was about to walk through, he set himself 100% to this personal journey, his personal story, demonstrating fully what a life looks like that has its heart and mind set on things above, and determined to walk in his destiny to the end. Knowing that his valley of tears would become a place of hope, new life, joy, and restoration for the world, as he broke the power of death through his resurrection, we now also live in the promise and expectation of resurrection from the dead into a world restored and made new when Jesus returns. As it's a day for celebrating women, we're going to look really quickly at three women in the Bible, two of whom were great examples of setting their hearts and minds in places that brought life and future blessing, and one who chose to set her heart on something really destructive, in which she lost the opportunity of a lifetime. There are so many inspirational women in the Bible, but here's one whom I admire personally. And her name is Deborah. And she lived about 1150 years BC in the land of Israel, in a time before the country had a monarchy and was ruled by a succession of judges. And Deborah was appointed by God as a judge and a prophetess at a time when those kind of roles were more commonly given to men, and she ruled as a great leader for about 60 years. She judged the people according to the laws of God, and she heard from God, passing his messages on to the people. And she famously held court under the palm tree of Deborah. Now, Deborah set her heart on living out her story and the plans that God had for her life, using her experiences and her gifts to bring wise judgments as a good leader. But she was living in really troubled times, in a nation, ruling over a nation that was absolutely paralysed with fear. For 20 years they had been oppressed by the vicious commander of a foreign army named Sisera. But Deborah was not caught up in the same fear that the people were, because her mind was set not on fear and the size of the army. Her mind was set on things above, and her faith and trust was in God. And so when God gave her a message to go to Barak, who was the commander, the leader of the Israelite army, with a message to go to battle against Sisera, she took God at his word and she didn't flinch. Even though Sisera had a formidable army of about 900 iron chariots, she fully expected that God would deliver on his promise and give the enemy into her hands. And so she was not surprised when eventually the battle was won. And she courageously accompanied the army into battle because Barak, her military leader, refused to go to battle unless she went with them. And in the face of his faltering courage, she says, "Of course I'll go with you, but understand that with an attitude like that, there'll be no glory in it for you. God will use a woman's hand to take care of Sisera." A courageous woman, a heart set on walking in her destiny, a mind set in faith to trust that God will do what he says he will do, and her hope set in God coming through for her. You can read the story of Deborah in Judges 4 and 5. Our second woman can be found in the New Testament in Mark chapter 5. We don't know much about her personal life story, but we do know about a valley of tears experience that she was going through. She had been experiencing a hideous health problem, really heavy bleeding for 12 years, and she was desperate. She had tried every doctor, every treatment, with no success. All had failed and there was no change in her condition at all. Her only hope is Jesus. Her condition had classed her as an unclean woman and the rule stated that she wasn't even allowed to go out. But she hears that Jesus is in the area and she sets her mind on a bigger picture, a better story, believing in faith that this man who claimed to be the Son of God had the power to heal her and to set her free. Her mind was so set that she was even prepared to defy the rules, which said she couldn't go out, she couldn't go to the temple, and she wasn't to touch people. She wrestled through the crowd to get to Jesus, set on the hope that if she could just touch the very edge of his clothing, she would be healed. And Jesus felt the power go out of him and recognised her faith and healed her to walk out her destiny from a place of restoration. Another inspirational woman whose place of pain became a place of healing and who refused to settle for anything less than God's personal intervention in her circumstances. Our third woman is called Herodias and she is a princess living in the time of the Roman Empire, contemporary with John the Baptist and the early days of the ministry of Jesus. Initially, she was married to Philip, who was a half-brother to Herod Antipas. But Herod has divorced his wife so that he can marry his half-brother's wife. And so Herodias is now living in Herod's palace with her daughter Salome. Now, John the Baptist is calling out this relationship as adulterous. And Herodias is furious. She is seething with resentment and nursing a huge grudge towards John the Baptist. Now one day King Herod throws a banquet in his palace for all of his noblemen, his guests. And as part of the entertainment, he asks Herodias's daughter Salome to come and dance for them. And he is so pleased with her performance that he calls her to him and in front of all his guests makes her an incredible offer. He says, "Whatever you wish for, even up to half of my kingdom, I'll give it to you." Wow, what an incredible offer and opportunity. And Salome goes to her mother and says, "What shall I ask for?" And Herodias, burning up with resentment and her grudge towards John the Baptist, misses that opportunity entirely. And she says to her daughter, "Bring me the head of John the Baptist on a plate." And Herod, forced to save face in front of his guests and deliver on his promise, has no choice but to give her what she asked for. Let's not be like Herodias, but let's follow the example of our first two women and set our hearts on pilgrimage, set our minds on things above, and set our hope fully on the grace of God. To close, did you know that God has a purpose and plan for your life and longs to be in relationship with you? Do you know how much he loves you and the incredible promises over your life that you can claim and walk in? Why not set your heart on walking out your personal life story with God, knowing his power and his presence with you as you walk through your valleys, setting your mind in faith that God is working all things together for good somehow, and confidently setting your hope on the grace that he pours over your life as you learn to walk with him on a journey of restoration and wholeness. God bless you. Let's pray. Father God, not only can we believe in you, but we can also belong to you and find our place in your family as your child. May each one of us be aware of you awakening us to your presence and your purposes for our lives, and the part you wrote for each one of us to play as we discover who we really are within your love and your nurture. Help us to set our hearts on the path you have marked for us, and may our lives flourish as we set our minds on your ways. Turn the places of weeping into places of healing and growth, and help us to set our hope fully on the grace and the endless mercy that you pour upon us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son sets free. Jesus died for me. Yes, he died.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and evermore. Amen.